Gonna do the podcast. A podcast we haven't done in a couple weeks. Oh, gonna get back on track doing the podcast. Beezy. What the hell is that guy? This is why the friendship is so strained. He's never around when I need him to be around. It's incredible. I'm calling him. I'm calling him right now. Where the crap are you, bro? You better pick up. Dude, where the hell are you?
I'm at the doghouse, bro. Where are you?
I'm at the farm where we're supposed to be recording the podcast.
I thought we were recording it here.
No, specifically said we're recording it here.
Oh, shit. Nah, just kick it, I guess.
Well, hey out there, all you beautiful savages, you almost holy meat suits that gravitate towards this cacophony of madness, you life shippers, you hidden brethren, all you frat disciples out there, welcome to this little thing that we call Fraternize with These Guys. I'm your humble host, Pastor Pinewood, and joining me through the brilliance that is a cell phone call-in, your other host. No one misses that ever. I can't throw nothing at you. Nothing. Now look, don't stop listening just because it's call in.
No.
I promise. Look, I've done this several times with several different podcasts. If you just give it like 10 minutes, it'll just be another episode. You won't even notice. Like, it'll completely go away. Like, our brain will adapt, and it'll be fine.
Another brick in the wall?
Something like that. I mean, you know, not exactly, but I wish we were as rich as the another brick in the wall folks. I'd take 10%. I'd take 1%.
I mean, I'm going to one-up you and go 2%.
2%.
2%.
Well, not only will you notice that it's a call-in, and, you know, that's unfortunate, but we'll kind of get there in a little bit. But I will say, we have some beautiful questions today. We have a great libation, and, of course, we have some goodies towards the end of the show. And, you know, just stick around. So we are a little bit off sometimes on the calls. And in all seriousness, the cell phone, you know, it's not something we think about much anymore. It's just part of us. But in our lifetimes, since we were born until now, we went from no cell phones to literally not being able to live without cell phones.
I know.
They can do everything. I mean, anything you wanted to do. It's incredible. Like, my cell phone takes better pictures than my $1,000 camera that I bought like 10 years ago.
Oh, yeah. And you know what's even crazier is our cell phones now have more technology packed into that little square than what they used to send people to the moon.
Yeah, and I think that was true like in 2007.
Right, with that Nokia brick.
Yeah, so just imagine what it is now. It's just incredible, and it just keeps doubling down over and over and over again.
Yeah. Exponential growth, I believe, is what they call that.
Something like that. Well, we're thankful to have the technology, and we want to start with apologizing for kind of being out and about. I tell you, illness and family situations and church stuff and COVID and just all kinds of stuff, you know, it really, really knocks down, especially when you're 3 hours away from each other.
Yeah, this has probably been the worst stretch of month and a half that I think we've had since we started this thing.
Yeah, I would say maybe like 5 years between the two of us.
Yeah, that's for sure. And it just happens to be both of us happening at the same exact time. So
yeah, and I made the joke a couple of weeks ago that, you know, when you turn 40, the old check engine light comes on. And apparently for us, it was about 35 is when that happened.
Yeah, that's for sure. I just put a lot of tape over it.
Yeah.
Black tape.
Yeah.
And took a shower the other day, and all that tape washed off. And I had some check engine lights, and I didn't even know what those signals meant.
Well, I tell you, that's a pretty surefire way to get rid of your check engine light. You just cover it with a piece of tape.
Exactly.
Yeah. Or as my wife does when her car starts making noise, you just turn the radio up a little bit.
Yeah. I never understood that myself.
Well,
I have I'm one of those OCD people that even if I have, like, I'm on my phone, if it pops up and says that I have a voicemail, I have to check my voicemail. I have to delete the voicemail or save it because I don't like that icon up at the top.
Like right then.
It bugs me.
Dude, the last time you were up here at the farm, we were doing the Halloween special. And
yeah.
Afterwards we went back in, we were watching some movies and you brought up your Xbox account and you're plugging us in some free movies or whatever. And
right.
Every time you'd close an app, you'd actually physically go in and like quit the app. And it was driving me crazy. I was like, why are you doing that? That you don't have to do that, bro. You just leave them open.
I do that.
In my poor Xbox, it's like dying in the background going, please, please close your tabs. There's like there's like thousands of tabs open for the last 7 years that I've owned the poor thing.
I know, right?
So last week, well, a couple weeks ago for Halloween, that's like one of our favorite holidays. And man, I had church stuff Halloween night. And by the time we were done, I was exhausted. We turned off our lights. We didn't hand out candy.
We live out in the country, so we kept the lights on, but nobody came by.
Okay.
So mainly because I just forgot to turn the light off because I myself was rather exhausted. And as you can tell, maybe I'm still kind of battling some sickness. I got down with the sickness. And it's not the COVID or nothing like that. Just a little bronchial action.
Yeah, we made sure.
And
no
allergies.
COVID.
Yeah, tis the season for me and allergies. So
since I've known you, it's kind of like country, once a year.
Well, being out in the country now, we've got cotton fields around us, and it's about that time to start harvesting.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they're fast in it.
All over. Yep. Yes, sir. So it usually knocks my dingus in the dirt every year, and this is no different. So.
All right. Well, long story short, or maybe long story long because we kind of rambled a bit, but just forgive us and we'll get back on track either here through the holidays or for sure after the holidays. But let's get out of here and how about we just get this thing rolling and go into a little libations?
I say we do it, sir.
Libations!
Mr. Beezy is kicking us off on libations today with, I believe, one of his old-time favorites.
Yeah. So, man, this one goes back a minute for me. Once I found it, I think you actually showed me this beer. And this was back when you were in Albuquerque, because that was the only place I knew of you could get it.
Yeah.
And, man, found a local store that carries it, and I think I buy it enough that they keep it stocked for me.
You're enough to keep them in business?
I am enough to keep them in business, at least to keep that, at least keep a couple sixes in the fridge for me.
Nice, nice.
So, but what we're drinking today is coming from the Left Hand Brewing Company. Excuse me. The Left Hand Brewing Company, if you want to check them out, their website is lefthandbrewing.com. I think it was like episode 39, we did another beer from them. It was their peanut butter milk stout.
Correct.
But this one is the Nitro Milk Stout. And believe it or not, we've got a pretty solid description on their website.
Nice.
This is the Milk Stout Nitro, super smooth with soft roastiness and mocha notes. Experience America's Stout. Milk Stout Nitro is a full sensory experience. Gaze at the mesmerizing cascade of all those tiny nitro bubbles. Breathe in the aromas of roasted taffies, milk chocolate, brown sugar, and vanilla cream. Savor the super smooth nitro sensation. And smile as the perfectly pillowy head coats your upper lip. This portable draft beer experience is good to go straight from the can or served like a pro in a glass. From the bottle, pour hard to release the nitro magic action inside. It is a 6% ABV. It's got 25 on the IBUs, and it is a milk stout style.
I'm kind of interested that, well, first and foremost, great description. Thank you, Left Hand Brewing, for putting some time into that.
I know, right?
And it's fascinating to me that this has been one of your favorite beers, or at least go-to beers for a while, and the IBUs are so high.
I think it's because the subtle sweet notes off balance the bitterness of it.
Well, that's
'cause you do get some of the bitter, and this is also, it's not one of those overly sweet beers. I think that you like this one.
Yes, I have in
because
the past,
it's not
for sure.
Overly sweet, and it does have the bitter. I mean, it kind of plays the field both ways.
Yeah, it does. I was a fan before. We'll see where we land here. Are you ready to get into those bad boys?
Yeah, I already opened it.
Oh, really? Well, so, let me open mine and we'll get to it.
Ah, Dan. Is that the Hillbilly Thunderstruck?
No, it's the two cellos Thunderstruck.
Well, it sounds like the two hill or the,
yeah, the Steven Seagulls.
The Hillbillies. Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you, just kind of as soon as you open the can, you kind of get an idea what you're in for. Like it's aromatic, and I don't know how yours is. Mine's probably 45, 50 degrees. It's not overly cold.
Right.
And so I immediately smell that lactose that milk stout is based on. You kind of get that primal base, and it just,
yeah,
it's elevated from there as soon as you drink it. I really like it. Like you said, the well-roundedness is probably its best feature for sure.
Yeah. And I definitely get the coffee on the backside of it with,
yeah,
a little bit of the milk chocolate. And then the brown sugar has got to be that sweetness that's coming in on the sides to kind of even everything out. And I love this beer. I think the reason I like it so much is because it is actually a nitro brewed beer. And there's not over carbonation. There's no carbonation technically because it's nitrogen shot.
Correct. Correct. And it might make points in your category. It's going to lose a little bit in mine. I'm not a huge fan of the nitro, and I don't know if it's a mouthfeel thing. I'm not 100% sure what it is about it. It's just not my cup of tea.
Are you saying you don't like that perfectly pillowy head as it coats your upper lip?
Something. Hey, man.
That's my favorite description ever.
Somebody really thought that out. You know, it sounds like a Beezy description, to be honest with you.
All right.
Well, like I said, I love the beer, and it's a beer that I could drink on the reg, and if I could find it here on a regular basis, I would buy it all the time. I had to go find this one special in Amarillo just to have it. So, man, I'm
nice.
Like, I wish it was closer. Like, I wish my tiny little town would embrace some good beer, because I would stop buying it in Amarillo and I'd buy it here. They don't listen to me. I tell them, like, every time I go in there.
Yeah, I know. Last time we were up there, we
gave him like six different beers.
Liquor store. It was like, here, you need to try this, try this, try this. If you can get this in, we will buy it.
Yeah.
But you definitely need to get it in because people will buy it. So,
well, we'll see.
What do you feel like for a rating on this one, bub?
So I'm gonna go low 80s. I'm gonna put it right in an 80.
Really?
84. And like I said,
wow.
the nitro hurts me, and it's sweeter than I remember. And I don't know if that's because maybe my palate has changed a bit. And also, I haven't had a beer in a while. And so maybe that factors in. But tonight, you know, where I'm sitting, it's just lacking a little bit. But again, don't let that take away from you buying the beer. I mean, it's a solid, solid beer. And I think if you see it, you should treat yourself and buy it.
Treat yourself.
So I guess you're coming in quite a bit higher.
Yeah, and it's funny you had said that, because I got to thinking about it. I had opened one of these up. I picked a six pack up, I think it was last weekend, and I was like, man, I haven't had this in a long time. So I opened up one and I drank it, and I don't know if I just wasn't in the mood for it or what the situation was, but I was like, I don't know if my palate has changed or what is going on, because it's not as good as I remembered it.
That's interesting.
And then I drank it tonight, and I was like, nope, there it is.
There it is back again,
I had some bad beef jerky, I guess.
Well, I tell you, beef jerky and milk stouts probably not the best complimentary items together.
No, I would reckon probably not. But of course, then again, who knows?
Yeah, who knows? I'm right there with you. All right, where are you at?
But I'm going pretty high. I'm going to go with a 95.
Dadgum, son. That's like way up there.
This is legit one of my go-tos. I think I've only rated two beers higher than this one.
Yeah.
And I'm referring to that fuzzy little man peach from Eccentric Brewing.
Yep, yep. Well, man, I don't know. It's I don't know. Both of them kind of miss points for me. But I see where you're coming from.
It's an excellent beer in my palate. I love this beer. The availability for me is regular.
Yep.
And the price point is not bad for a 6%.
Yep.
It's $12, $11.99 for a 6-pack.
Yep.
I really can't really say enough good things about this beer. That's why I'm giving it a 9.5 out of 10.
Well, I think that's respectable for sure. And we'll kind of, you know, if folks out there, they kind of want to split the difference between the two, you still got a high B, low A ranked beer. So I think, you know, go get you some.
Oh yeah. Definitely need to try this one out.
All right. You ready to get into a little four questions?
Four questions.
So was that a yes or?
I reckon so.
All right.
Four questions.
Hey.
I did it right.
You just did it right.
Doesn't happen all the time, but every once in a while.
By George, he's got it.
All right, the way I understand it, Beezy's got 1 and 3. Old Pinewood's going to take 2 and 4, and let's just shoot from the hip and get at it.
Question number one. Is it rude to pick fruit off of your neighbor's tree if a branch is hanging in your backyard?
Ooh. Dang, that's a good question. Is it rude? Maybe. Is it proper?
It's God's tree, yeah, man.
It's God's tree.
It's God's tree.
Fruit, man. God owns the fruit. Well, I would assume, I mean, if it's hanging on your side, technically it's yours.
It's got that dangle in your yard.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I say you go out there and you get your apples, and if they got poop to say about it, they can cut off that branch.
Pick that low-hanging fruit.
There you go. Now, the other other question is, how far do you take it? What if the branch is like 12 foot in the air and you got a ladder now and you're up there, you know, collecting fruit just on your side of the fence? I mean, just real rigid, making sure that you measure it and everything, and they come out one day and your side of the tree is just bare. Everything's picked and their side of the tree is just laden with fruit. And they're like, what the heck happened? How much effort did this guy go through with to get the fruit that was on his side of the fence?
I mean, I think at that point it doesn't matter. It's just like the football crossing the end zone. That line goes all the way up into space. As soon as that tree branch crosses that property line threshold, fair game, Bubba.
Yeah, I'm definitely with you there. So the question is it rude? And I would venture to say, if my neighbor did that, I don't think I would consider it rude. I think I would consider it an act of kindness that he didn't make me trim the tree.
Oh, that's a good point. I didn't even think about that one.
Because you could be a dick, right? As a neighbor, you could be like, hey, man, you got to cut that tree all the way up, and you just have like a flat top, like a flat-sided fruit tree.
So like the tree that we had when we lived in town, both of our neighbors had just monstrosities of trees, which is odd for where we live.
Sure.
And one the neighbor on the west side of us, his tree was so big that it actually had grown into the power lines.
Oh wow!
And Yeah, our power lines.
Of course.
That go over our backyard to our house. His tree had so rudely encroached on our property. And the guy never even lived there. He just owned the property. We're like, hey, you need to kind of trim this bush, bro.
Yeah.
It's getting out of hand.
Yeah. He ever take care of it?
Oh, yeah. He was a nice old guy.
That's pretty funny.
It didn't have any fruit.
It's just a tree.
Kind of sucked. But they had a bunch of birds, so we got to practice a little pot shots with our BB guns.
Nice. Hey, that works. A little trade-off there.
But I don't know. I think rude, who cares? Be rude. It's your backyard. You're paying for it.
Yeah, I think it all depends on the attitude of your neighbor. You know, whoever's growing the tree, if they understand that, well, the sacrifice for allowing it to grow on my property is I get an apple every couple of weeks in the spring, then, you know, it's fine. And if they're going to be jerks about it, well, I'm just going to come out with a chainsaw and just cut my side off.
Yeah, there you go.
So who's rude now?
You want to see rude?
Yeah, I'll show you rude.
See rude. I can cut it off. I'm going to throw some tar on the end of it so it can't grow back.
Yeah. And if you're really, really mean, you could just plant a row of bamboo right there on the fence. And bamboo kind of has like hang on. I'm going to get there. It propulates.
Propulate.
Yeah, whatever. Underground, like with the root systems. And so eventually he'd have bamboo in his side. And I'd be like, look, you started it, bro. I'm just finishing it.
I tell you what, if you're going to go that way, hopefully he doesn't securely manicure his lawn, because I'm going to just go spend most of the summer picking up sticker burrs out of my yard because I got plenty of them.
Oh, you're just going to throw them over there.
And then I'm just going to litter the entire yard with stickers. I was like, well, here you go. Enjoy growing this.
Nice. Not only enjoy growing it, enjoy trying to get rid of it. Good luck.
Keep it in your lawn.
Yeah. Well, I tell you, that'd be a pretty messed up prank on somebody. Just get a whole bunch of grass burrs in a bucket and just spread them out on their lawn without them knowing it, like in the fall.
Oh, and they have a very beautiful, like,
oh, yeah,
the St. Augustine grass that suffocates sticker burrs.
Uh-huh.
So you don't ever see those, and then you just all of a sudden, oh, bro,
It's messed up.
Brutal.
It's messed up.
Because me, I'm going to step on it. Knowing that I don't have sticker burrs in my yard, I'm going to fall onto my back and roll over into my nice, comfortable grass.
Oh, yeah.
And pick that ugly sticker burr out of my foot.
Yep.
But now I have sticker burrs from my crack to my neck.
And also a whole bunch in your ground that are going to grow next spring and ruin that nice, beautiful lawn.
I'm murdering somebody.
Yeah,
there's no rude. That's straight death.
Yeah, it would be pretty. That's messed up. I know what it takes to keep a yard pretty, and I'd be pretty hot.
I do too. That's why I don't keep my yard pretty.
Well, that's fair. Yeah, that's a fair point. All right, question number two has nothing to do with fruit. It is, why do we have wisdom teeth if everyone gets them removed? Sub question, does the removal of our wisdom teeth explain why we're all so stupid?
Speak for yourself. I still have my wisdom teeth.
I didn't ask the question.
I still got my wisdom teethers.
Oh,
and
nice.
I'm a 39th degree doctor in multiple fields. I'm just saying.
So you kept all your wisdom, huh?
I kept all the wisdom. It's funny because the wisdom teethers, they actually got that name because they grow in your face, or actually they erupt is the term that the dentists use.
Yes.
They erupt so much further down in your life that you're supposed to be smarter than a child when they come out.
Well, supposed to be.
Now, some of the stuff that my wife has been showing me on TikTok here lately, has me second guessing some folk.
Might negate some of that.
I truly hope they don't have those wisdom teeth.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's funny. I learned this kind of sort of on Rogan to begin with. and then I researched a little bit afterwards. But our evolutionarily speaking, our mouths are getting smaller.
Correct.
And so as the wisdom teeth grow in, for most people, because their mouths are getting smaller, and it's because we're eating softer and softer foods.
Right, right. And we're not eating
we're not scavenging
copious amounts of like raw corn.
Yeah, you know, in tough meat and all that stuff that you would eat
where we don't have to masticate our food as much.
Correct. And you know, if you think about it, all the things that are like comfort foods are soft. We like tender meat. We like mashed potatoes. We like stuffing. We you know, it's November. I got stuffing on the brain, but it's soft foods. And very rarely do we're like, oh yeah, you know what tastes really, really good? Some sunflower seeds, but we just eat the whole seed, like the shell and all. Like nobody wants to do that. So our mouths are decreasing. They actually make this little thing you can put in your mouth like a retainer, but it stretches it stretches your mouth out. It like stretches on the top part of the roof of your mouth. And this guy that was on his program, he said, I did it for a year, no exceptions, 365 days. And he said his wisdom teeth like straightened.
What?
Yeah, they were coming in, you know, what do they call that, impacted? And by the time he was done for the year, both of his bottom wisdom teeth had straightened out enough where he didn't have to remove them. Like our mouths are just genetically getting smaller where they can't handle the extra teeth.
That's insane.
Yeah, and so the whole idea about putting braces on and all that is doing is fixing a mouth that's too small, fixing the teeth in a mouth that's too small. So you're just attacking the symptom is all that you're doing. It's bananas.
I just pop one of them teethers out and you're good for another couple generations.
Apparently so. Yeah, but it won't be too long. Like three teeth will be like a status symbol.
I got my front tooth for cutting. I got my back tooth for chewing. That other one? Sucking blood.
It's got a hole in it.
It got a hole in it. That's when I touch it with metal or bite aluminum.
It's like, bro, Brad, that's a cavity, bro. You need to go get that thing taken out.
Mama says that's my vampire tooth.
Mama gave me Mountain Dew instead of milk whenever I was a baby. Good grief. Well, it is pretty fascinating. Boy. Now, so you don't have yours out. Does the producer have hers out?
I believe she does. Which is how I was able to trick her into marrying me.
She'd probably agree 100% with you on that.
That old dummy.
It's like, well, shouldn't have got your wisdom teeth taken out.
Should have kept them wisdom teeth.
That'll learn you.
You just been the learned one.
Yeah, barely. Make sure you keep your barely tolerant teeth in because, you know, she's not going to be able to tolerate you if you start taking out her tolerant teeth.
I tell you what's going to happen. I aggravate too many of those. She's going to knock all my teeth out.
Oh, that's a fair point. You'd be left with just your wisdom teeth.
Yeah. And that's only because she couldn't reach them.
I was just going to say the only reason they don't come out is because she couldn't reach back that far.
She tried to hit me with that rolling pan.
Oh, my gracious. All right, man. Well, I think we answered that one pretty good. And, oh, by the way, I had mine taken out all four at one time. They kept me awake, and I got dry sockets on the bottom, too. And
that's terrible.
It was about the most horrific thing in the whole world. And you had to go back, like, every week and get them repacked with that stuff. And then they'd pull the old stuff out, and they'd shoot cold water in there. And, man, like, it made my toenails bleed. Like, it was awful. It was the worst thing. And I look back on it now, and I realize that the first day I got home, I was like, okay, I'm going to do good. I had a little bit of water. I had some soup, and I went to bed. And then the next day, my teeth hurt, and I was like, I'm going to drink until my teeth don't hurt. And that's why I got dry sockets, because I just drank copious amounts of beer for, like, the first 3 days after I got my wisdom teeth taken out.
Well, there's your problem right there. You should have stuck with the vacuum. Well, it's clear, so it doesn't get stuck in your white teeth.
I should have done something different because it was awful. They told me not to drink out of the straw. They didn't say anything about not drinking Keystone Light, and they should have.
You need to be more clear on these.
You've got to be very specific.
I think you may be one of the reasons why we have people suing McDonald's and winning.
Hey, I owned up, man.
It's because you had your wisdom teeth taken out.
I didn't sue nobody. And hey, just so you know, I've read Proverbs like 100 times. That's the wisdom book. It doesn't say anything about keeping your wisdom teeth. Not one time. So I feel like
that's because they didn't have any need to have them teepers yanked out back then. Oh, yeah. Their face was big enough.
their faces were big enough. That's why Solomon was so wise. He just had a big ass mouth.
Exactly right.
I'll try that from the pulpit, see how that goes over.
I'd be interested to see how that goes. Put it up on YouTube.
Okay, you got it. Let's go on to question number 3. What you got?
I really hope you're prepared for this one, bro. How will my cat react if she finds my poop in her litter box?
Bro, I was taking a drink, man.
I've read this question about 150 times, and I can't quit laughing.
Oh my gosh. How will my cat react if she finds my poop in her litter box?
All right.
Wow.
If you haven't been pooping in your cat's litter box yet, that's why that cat owns you.
Yeah. I bet you've been pooping in your cat's litter box. You probably don't have your wisdom teeth anymore.
I tell you what's going to happen. If you don't start pooping in your cat's litter box, you're never going to know. So go ahead and get it going.
But, just go ahead and try it.
Yeah. I mean, here's the deal. If you don't have a cat at this point, and this is just my PSA, get a cat. Get a cat box and then start shitting in the cat box from day one. That way it knows this is my domain. You shall not encroach unless I allow it. And then that's how you potty train your cat.
Oh, weird. I don't think I've ever heard that because I don't think that works.
I mean, it's a theory I'm working on.
I would like to see some evidentiary processing on this theory. Maybe a YouTube channel devoted completely to it.
I mean, we got to get some serious funding. I'm looking for some scholarship grants, some science departments and such.
You know, I'll say, reading some of the stuff that our government funds, you might have a shot, bro.
That's no joke.
You might be able to pitch that to somebody, and some idiot up on Capitol Hill be like, oh, yeah, that's good. Give him $100 million. Be like, oh, crap.
Probably doesn't have his damn wisdom teeth.
This is the kind of stuff we need to be investing in, Frank. Let's go. Write the check.
Wisdom teeth unite.
Yeah, that's pretty good. I wonder what, in all seriousness, how would a cat react to that? Like, they would just ignore it, wouldn't they? Have you seen those TikTok videos where they, like, rub a wrapper together and the cat can't handle it, and so they do that? Oh, it's hilarious.
No.
There's these stupid videos where they'll do, they'll, like, run their finger down a comb, or they'll, like, rub some wrapping paper together and make this weird noise, and the cat can't handle it. And they're like, bleh, bleh.
No shit.
It's hilarious.
I kind of want a cat. I tell you what I'm going to start doing is shitting in his cat box first, though.
Oh, man.
You gotta establish the alpha male.
I guess that would do it.
Well, I can't disagree.
I tell you what.
There's nothing more sacred to a man than when he's sitting in his house drinking a beer while on his throne.
Yeah, that's true. I tell you what, knowing some
it
cats.
It has to be the same for the animal kingdom.
Maybe. But what about this? What if you did the deed in the litter box and you're like, see who's the alpha? And then you went and sat on your couch and the cat went over there and he sat in the litter box and he just looked at you, never took his eyes off you, and just ate it.
And you may have won the battle, sir, but you have not won the war. Taco Bell, here I come. Eat that.
At that point, I'd be like, all right, cat, you own it. I'll leave everything to you in my will. Like, I'm done. You're going to eat my face.
Oh, he put a hit out on me. I don't even know how he did that.
That's right. That's right. Oh, my gosh. It's an interesting scene to think about. Well, I'll tell you, question number four kind of sort of ties into that, and I bet the answer is different with a cat than all the other animals.
Okay.
So the question is, do animals actually enjoy being kept as pets, or do they hate it, and do they hate you?
Well, obviously, the answer is, if you have a cat, yes, yes, and yes.
I mean, you're kind of like his servant.
I mean, he enjoys being kept as a pet because he's got shelter. And he hates it because he knows he's being kept as a pet.
Mm.
And he hates you because you're keeping him as a pet.
I mean, that makes sense.
His only solace is his cat box.
And you done crapped in it.
Not yet. That's how you turn the tide. Maybe that's why. Maybe they've been sitting too high on their cat box, and they just need to be kicked down a peg. Maybe that's why they're always pissed off, and everybody on the internet's like, "Oh, cats always hate everybody." Because you're not shitting in their cat box.
Okay,
you got to bring them down a peg.
All right, I like the way you think, my friend.
Because you got the animal kingdom. I mean, some of the biggest mammals are cats.
Well, yeah. Well, I
the
don't.
Biggest predators.
Predators,
the biggest
yes.
Predators are cats, and there's a lot more big ass cats than there are canines. I mean, because you got Django ate your baby.
Yeah, that's about it.
That's about it. Wolf.
Yeah, you got a wolf, but they're kind of limited in range.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think the big cats are a little more limited in range than the wolves are. You've got quite a bit of the northern areas with wolves. I
highly disagree.
Well, I don't know. Think about it. Like your tigers
mountain lion?
Well, a mountain lion, yes, but that's the only one.
Well, you got leopards.
Well, that's a mountain lion. It's the same subspecies.
Jaguars.
It's the same thing.
Well, I mean, all of them are the same thing because they're big cats.
Well, no, but I'm talking lions and tigers. Bears, oh my.
Can bears, oh my?
I beat you to it. Beat you to it, sucka. But I mean,
oh, no, you didn't.
They're very
not
limited.
Not in my headphones. Not in my headphones, you didn't.
There's a limited area where lions are and tigers are. But anyway, look, coming back to the question, I think dogs, pretty much, if you're not like completely and total sadistically evil towards them, I'm pretty sure they love you regardless of what you do.
I mean, even if you have a shitty day and you come home and you take it out on your dog
take it
once
out of the
or
dog.
Twice.
They still love you.
He's still, tomorrow, when you open that door, oh, shit, Dad is here.
Yeah, yeah. And
wagging his tail, super happy.
My dogs, it doesn't even take them a day. I can beat the wham out of my dog for, like, pooping on the floor or something. And, like, within the next 10 minutes, he's like, we good? And then his tail goes, and, you know, he's ready to go again.
I mean, to be fair, all three of your dogs had their wisdom teeth taken out.
Yeah, all three of them, they're pretty special. I'm going to tell you, pretty special.
Oh, boy.
The oldest Dotson is pretty chill. If it was just him by himself, it'd be all right. But the younger Dotson and then the stupid Healer, I'm telling you, bro, it's a circus in my house on a daily basis.
Oh, yeah. I've been there. I've seen it.
Yep, it's something else. But I can't think of, like, you know, every other animal, you never think about, well, are they happy? Like I don't think they register happiness. I think they register existence. And they're being fed. They got water. They got shelter. They're relatively warm and or cool, depending on the breed. And you pet them every once in a while, and you take them on walks. I think they're pretty happy.
I got one that I want to add to the list, which is something that we have actually been considering getting as a pet. And it's a pidge.
A what?
A little pig.
Oh, a pig. Okay. All right. Well.
Yeah, we call it little pidges.
Okay. Like a little potbelly
guy? I'm going to call Bacon.
I mean, it makes sense.
She's been showing me so many again TikTok.
God dang TikTok, man! That's just the devil.
Showing me these dang videos of these cute ass little pigs running around. It's like, oh my god, I want to bite your face! You're so cute.
Well, you know they grow up, right?
I know, and then they could become delicious.
Oh, I see. You're thinking full circle.
Hell yeah, circle of life, baby. Elton John sang it.
Well, there's something to that. There's something to that.
Because what's going
to
happen is I'm going to raise the pig, eat the pig, get a cat, poop out that pig in the cat's cat box.
Man, you really have come full circle.
I don't know why we keep coming back to that.
I don't know.
I think it's just a great question.
Well, I think also, do animals enjoy being kept as pets? I think you should also ask maybe that for farm animals as well. Do they have a good existence up until that one bad day? And if they do, and that should be the goal for farmers, is to make their existence pretty pleasurable, or maybe not pleasurable, but I don't know, sufficient, where they're not mistreated and blah, blah, blah. Comfortable is a good word. You know, I think that's a goal for us to have for the animal kingdom.
I agree. I mean, you look at horses. There's some horses that have a better living than I do.
Yeah, that's a fair point. That is a fair point.
And, I mean, I'm just trying to think of some of the domesticated animals. You get, like, for America, would be cat, dog, occasional pig.
Yeah.
Horses are fairly domesticated.
Agreed.
Or common. But you get other countries like oxen and stuff like that. They've domesticated the cows for agricultural purposes.
Yeah, and we're not even thinking like little guys, like guinea pigs and ferrets and parrots.
Yeah, nobody even cares about those. Yeah. Those don't even exist.
Yeah. Have you ever been around like a parrot, a pet? They're creepy. They're creepy.
They stink to high heaven.
Well, that's true. But they're just weird little critters, and they live for like 40 years.
A ferret?
No, a parrot.
Oh, like macaque?
Yeah. Well, something like that. Yeah, it's usually more it's got a bigger vocabulary than yours does, but yes. Like
no, that's
parrot.
What the bird is called. It's called a macaque.
Yes, I know. I was playing the pun, sir.
Oh, no, it's a macaw.
Yeah.
jokes on macaque.
which is usually where they land. Hey-o.
Hey-o. yeah, but...
So I think
I've always wanted to own a ferret.
I don't know, man. They're weird little dudes. I like them.
Now, I've heard they are some smelly little bastards.
They do
but
smell.
But I think that's why I like them, because I'm a smelly little bastard myself.
Yeah.
And that's why I've got a basset hound, because she stinks to high heaven as well.
Well, ferrets are worse than that. I had a buddy growing up that had some, and they just roamed his house. Like, he didn't have a pen for them. They just lived, like, in his closet, and you'd be hanging out watching
that's
a movie.
Legit.
Yeah, and they just, every once in a while, they just, like, come out and run across the room. You're like, what? What the heck? Was that a rat? And they're like, no, that's Frank, or whatever his name was.
Threw a marmot in the tub.
So, you know, there's a place for a ferret. And of course, you got the Big Lebowski joke. You can do that like once a week to the wife. It's a win-win.
Yeah.
It's a win-win.
I don't know. That's another thing I've debated on, just because I know they're a very hyper-intelligent species. And, well, from what I've heard.
I don't know.
They're just adorable.
Yeah, they are pretty cute. I will say...
Or like a weasel or an otter. If I could have an otter, oh my God.
Otter be pretty legit. If he had like its own little tub, like that's just, that was
hell
like his
yeah.
little domain.
That's what I'm talking about right there.
You could throw him some clams and he'd like beat them apart on his chest.
Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be pretty
just
awesome.
Hulk nasty at pow, 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 pow.
Yep. I would, I'd probably frequent your house more if you had an otter.
I'd spend more time here too. I'd go... Hey, you guys, come over to my house. See my otters. Knowing everybody that knows me, they're gonna be like, I don't know. We've seen you naked before, bro.
Yeah, that's fair. That's fair. Have you ever seen that video where that group of otters like fights off an alligator?
Oh yeah, those Amazon otters.
Yeah, but they legit like, no, bro, you're not coming into our house. Like, this is our
house.
Yeah,
buddy. I tell you, an even better one I saw not too long ago. It was two rival otter factions.
Nice.
They had an all-out gang war. You just see the water starts bubbling and going towards each other, and the bubbles collide, and it's just a shit ton of otters fighting in the river.
That's hilarious. I don't know why, but in my mind, every time I see otters in the wild, or I've seen them in like on lakes that we fished in New Mexico, had some, and then when I've seen them on National Geographic or whatever, I always imagine in my head that they have an Irish accent. I have no idea why. I don't even think they have otters in Ireland.
Crazy bastard over here. Hey, sit there taking pictures. Doesn't know what's going on over here. They're trying to eat my clam. Let me alone, you wanker.
All right, man. Good four questions. Let's get out of there and ready for some cinemize.
I reckon so.
Dude, that was kind of loud at the beginning, and it frightened me like a little bit.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, kind of startled.
I'm pretty good on my end.
All right. Well, hey, Cinemize this week is going to be a little pretentious, and both of us, I think, had to do just a touch of research to remind ourselves of the ones that we really enjoyed. I know I did. Now, I had one right off the bat that I knew exactly what I was going to pick, but the other ones I had to kind of look up. But the question is, or the category, I don't know whatever you call that for cinemize, but anyway, it is the best...
Topic?
There you go. Okay, best movies made before 1950.
Yeah, and this one, like you touched on it, it had me stumped for a bit. Mainly because I'm not just a huge, huge fan of just that wicked old cinema.
Right.
I really like technology and what it has done in the cinema industry.
Absolutely.
So, I mean, the advancements, I can appreciate to an extent what was done at the time, but still, I'm not going to go watch it.
Yep.
But I did have a couple of them. I had two of them. One that I knew for a fact had to have been on the list. And then another one that I was pretty sure was.
Okay.
And then my third one I had no idea was as old as it actually was.
Interesting.
But right. My number one is Fantasia by Disney.
Oh, yeah.
Did you know that came out in 1940? I knew it was old. I knew it was before... 50? I just didn't realize it was 1940.
Okay, I knew it was, but the only reason I did is because I used Fantasia as a way to prove that Christian music, quote-unquote, is there's no such thing as Christian music, only Christian lyrics. And I used Fantasia to make that argument, and I'll have to elaborate on that some point in the future, but there's these crosses between like old Christian music and old classical music. And then, if you remember on Fantasia, they had some really dark elements in the original.
Yeah.
And so...
Well, they did the Sorcerer's Apprentice.
Yeah, well, yes, but also the end, I think Night on Bald Mountain was was one also, and it has some... It's creepy. Like, if you watch it, it's really weird. And anyway, I thought that that was very good, but that's the only reason I knew. I would have put it more like in the 60s or 70s.
I knew it was... flirting with that 50s line. I thought it may have actually been 52 to 55-ish.
Right.
But it came in 1940, and I was like, oh, thank God, I have to find another one.
Nice. Yeah.
But Fantasia, oh, go ahead.
It's amazing they were able to do animation at that level, at that point. And,
yeah.
And imagine the time it took, frame by frame, to draw that crap out. I mean, it was such an
color.
Oh my gosh, it was such an undertaking.
That's what Walt Disney. He had that slave train driving.
Yeah, he did.
I hear the trains are coming.
Well, you know,
it's coming around a bit.
Walt Disney was the angel. It was Roy Disney. Dadgum Roy Disney. All right. Well, that's one. What else you got?
Okay. I feel like this should be on both of our lists because it's just a shoe-in. Is 1939, The Wizard of Oz.
Yep. Definitely on my list. Came in at number 3 on my list.
Really?
Yep.
Yep. Very interesting.
And something about it, it holds up. You can watch that today with your family, with your kids.
It does.
And it holds
up. It really does.
And I don't know how that's possible. I can't think of another movie, even from 70. Well, maybe, I don't know. But very rarely do you have an old film that you can sit around and watch with your kids and your teenagers and your 20-year-olds and your adults and your elderly folks and, like, everybody.
And everybody sings along and knows everything through the movie.
Yeah, and enjoys watching the show.
Yeah.
Like, the movie's good. The acting's okay. It's decent. It's just really good. It holds up.
Right, right. I'm with you. That's why it's my numero doski.
Nice.
In 1939.
Yeah, man. It's crazy. I mean,
haven't
even gotten to World War II yet. It's crazy. It is crazy. All right, what's number 3?
All right, I don't know that you have seen this one or if you have one time, but The Adventures of Robin Hood from 1938.
Yeah. So
the leading role was a cat named Errol Flynn. Oh, Errol.
Yeah, I tell you, that's E-R-R-O-L. A pretty solid name, Errol Flynn.
Errol Flynn, yeah.
Yep.
So I did some more digging on this movie because it's been quite a while since I've seen it, but I watched it several times growing up, and it stuck with me. This movie, in 1938, it cost $2 million to make. And this was the most expensive Warner Brothers film that had been made at that time.
Really?
It actually turned out to be the biggest moneymaker for them in 1939. So, okay. And for those of you that are curious, I did some Googlage, and $2 million in 1939 money, that equates to roughly $39,469,064.75 in today money.
Wow, that's still a cheap movie.
There's some walking around change.
Right.
Hell, you can't even get a CGI anything for that nowadays.
Yeah, that's a good point. Well, so that original Robin Hood with Errol Flynn was it's one of the few that has a 100% Rotten Tomatoes score on both critics and audience.
Really?
Yes, one of the few. Casablanca, to put it in perspective, only has 97, which is like one of the greatest movies of all time.
Oh, gross.
Oh, come on.
I know that has to be in your list.
It's not, actually. It's not on my list.
Thank you.
And I'll explain why. But do you have any mentions, or did you kind of go with 3 and that was it?
I had a couple. Just I went down the Disney rabbit hole.
Oh yeah.
And I'm going to say an honorable mention just because it actually was in 1951.
Oh, nice.
But one of my first favorite Disney movies that didn't have a male lead was Alice in Wonderland. And that was 1951.
Okay. I didn't know that was so old either.
Yep. Yeah, the very first one was Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs.
Yeah.
I think that was 32.
Man, that's crazy.
And then it was Dumbo and Pinocchio and then Cinderella, I believe. And
okay.
Then what was the other one? Alice in Wonderland. So
that works. So I will I'll negate my number 3 and I'll throw in another one. But
okay.
I did it not as maybe quote unquote like the best movies? Because I think Citizen Kane and Casablanca, I think you have to put those at the top. You know, 1941, 1942, just quintessential Americana type movies, and still movies that people go back and look at, and they brag on the acting and blah blah blah. And you know, it's an old movie, but it's,
I mean,
not...
frankly, my dear, I just don't give a damn.
That is not those. That's Gone with the Wind, sir.
Frankly, Pinewood, I don't give a shit.
That is Fraternize with These Guys circa 2021. Okay, so my three, if I had to put them, and now what I wanted to do was pick movies that I actually like to watch and would watch again. And so,
well, that was my three.
Okay, so going 3-1, well, least favorite to favorite. The third one is The Treasure of the Sierra Madre. And it's this classic old movie about a gold rush, and they go and they find some gold, and they end up killing each other to try to make out with the gold themselves, and then they end up all dying. It's a really good movie, and just kind of,
I like the premise.
Yeah, it's great, really, really good. The second one is the Maltese Falcon, which is kind of one of these old film noir type movies. Really, really good mystery murder, and it's kind of dark, and I really like it. And the Maltese Falcon is just this little falcon thing that's made out of this Maltese stone. And anyway, really good, definitely worth a watch. And then my absolute favorite is actually a Charlie Chaplin film called City Lights. And we did, in the orchestra, we did a live action show where we actually played the music as an orchestra for the movie.
And, oh, nice.
Yeah, we toured it through Texas, and man, it was so much fun. And I know for a fact that that's why I enjoy that movie so much, but I can watch it today, you know, several times a year, and it just doesn't get old. It's classic. It's entertainment. It's kind of slapstick, vaudevillian style humor. Chaplin's great, and it's one of the better films, in my opinion, that he made. It's one of the better films of that era altogether.
Interesting.
Honorable mentions, Mr. Smith Goes to Washington. I really do
like
that film.
I thought you were about to say Mr. and Mrs. Smith. I was like, bro, that was like 2021.
No, not that one. But anyway, so I think there's some good old movies in there for sure.
I'll tell you, as I was diving down this rabbit hole, I started... I found this website that did the greatest movies released from like 1990 or 1900. Wait, is that right? 1900.
1900. Yeah, I gotcha.
All the way up to 1950.
Oh, wow. Okay. Interesting.
And it did it by decade.
Okay.
So every 10 years, and you could check each year. And I was like, there were some movies in the 30s that I was reading. And I was like, oh, my God, this sounds like a great freaking movie.
Yeah, it's crazy. Some of them are fantastic.
And there was this one, I was like, how the hell did that release at this time? Because it was about some chick who was married, and she ended up wanting to get divorced from her husband because she met a guy that – lived the bachelor life, and she's like, I want to live the bachelor life, see? So she divorces her husband and then goes out and Flanders and ends up coming back to her husband and getting remarried to him. It was like, how the French did that shit happen in like 1932?
Yeah, well, they were masters of nuance, man. That's just, they could fly under the radar with that crap.
I don't know, man. I may have to take some time and do some old diving into some of the cinematic classics.
All right. Well,
the not so classics.
I'd go down that road with you. It's a lot of fun.
All right, then.
All right. Let's get out of here. Let's do a little Thinky Blinders.
Cool.
Thinky Blinders. Well, as you know, four questions, we kind of have a little bit of insight before we go in. Thank you, Blinders. It's just that. It's blind. Now, I hear old Beasy's got a pretty good one, and mine is not so good. It's kind of more run-of-the-mill, so I'm going to go first. How about that?
I like it.
All right, Mr. Beasy, you have been alone on a desert island for nearly a decade, and and you got your Wilson and everything, and you're finally brought back to civilization, and you're heralded as a hero, and you're handed the keys to a presidential suite in a 5-star motel or hotel, and you get to stay there for a month. What is the first thing that you do upon entering your hotel room?
Ask if the porn channel's unlocked. I'm there for a month. There's going to be a little bit of hanky-panky.
By yourself?
I'm locked there by myself.
It doesn't necessarily.
I'm gonna hanky panky with Pamela Anderson.
It doesn't necessarily say you have to stay by yourself. You don't have to sin against God just because you came in and got a 5-star hotel given to you. You heathen.
Well, he knew when he created me that he should avert thine eyes. Oh, he's gonna destroy this hotel room. I'm looking away.
Wow. Yeah. Oh, you made it dirty real fast.
Well, would you expect anything different?
I don't know. I kind of half did expect something a little different. I don't know why, but I did.
Well, joke's on you, sucker.
I guess so.
I don't know. I think a decade I've been on an island, and they're like, oh, you're a hero. Here's a month in a presidential suite. What do you want your first thing to do? I'm probably gonna make sure the porn channel's unlocked, and then make sure the TV can be seen while I'm in the kajuzis, shaving, bathing, and spanking.
Good grief, bro!
And
it's a family show.
I'm gonna have to. Oh wow, this is not a family show. I'm ordering the biggest steak they offer.
Okay. Now we have some overlap.
I don't want to have to cook something. I've been doing that for 10 years.
Right. Like crabs and whatever you can find.
I need a wife from 1920. Cook, clean, and do my clothes.
My first thing was I wanted to take a shower. I want to eat a whole bunch. And then I want to invite a whole bunch of people up because I've been alone for 10 years.
I don't know. You're going to have an anxiety attack because there's too many people. You've been alone.
You're probably for 10 right about years. That. Yeah, that's fair. Maybe I invite one person.
I'm going to ease myself into the population by watching some 2-on-2 porn.
Good grief.
Just like, all right, okay, here we go. I remember what civilization's like. This is good. I'd say hello to the bellboy. I may venture down the hall, go hit the rec pool or whatever they got.
Right, right.
But you got to ease yourself into that kind of situation.
I see. Well, maybe you're right. I don't know. I don't know.
There's no baby. 39th degree doctor. Remember no. that.
Look, I know we're getting a little off into the risque, and I don't mean to offend any of our Christian listeners, but I just wanted to think about the way things are going now. Can you imagine what pornography is going to be in 10 years from now?
Has it changed? I'm pretty sure that it's all been the same thing. Just more
technically the mechanics haven't changed, but the classifications and the categories, I mean, like there's weird stuff going on.
I don't know. I don't venture to porn websites, so you're going to have to enlighten me, Pastor.
Well, I'm definitely not going to go down that route with you, but I would assume that it continues to get more and more debased. Right. Definitely not a church show. But it's not getting more tame. I mean, we're not going back to, you know, just some softcore stuff in the 60s. I mean, it's getting worse and worse all the time.
I mean, I feel like that's always been there, but it was more niche.
I don't know.
And you had to do a lot of work to find people that were into being punched in the face. Wow. While having
punched
an orgasm
in the face?
Or something. I don't know.
Oh my gosh. All right. Well, before this goes off track completely, let's salvage what we can. why don't you give me your thinky blinder? We'll get the heck out of here.
Only because this has gone so far off the rails. I'm hoping to keep you harnessed off the rails.
See where you go
with this one.
Okay, great.
You are trapped in your most hated person's body. You have 48 hours to ruin their lives. You may not kill or be killed. What do you do?
Man, that's a good question. So my most my most hated person?
Me.
No.
From 2003.
Well, okay, yeah. If I was going to do that, then I would I'd just have you throw all of your instruments off a roof, like right before college tryouts or something like that. That'd be pretty fun. I would have enjoyed that.
I'd borrow a trumpet and get first chair.
Yeah, you're probably right. Probably would. I would surgically remove your lips.
Okay, well, I mean, I'd play the trumpet with the butthole, I guess.
I don't know, man. Like, so I figure if somebody was going to do that to me, I think the way that they could really ruin my life is to make phone calls and to just overly insult and defame and debase people that I know and love. Like, so you get
or
a phone,
be on a podcast.
Well, maybe, yeah. But you get a phone call from Pinewood, and instead of like our chipper regular conversations, it's just like it's complete and total just horrendous crap that he's just spewing. And he does that for like 3 minutes and then hangs up and he calls the next person. And you do that to, you know, your 10, 15 most favorite people in your phone or whatever. And then by the time you get your body back and you, everybody hates you because you're just like, dude, what the heck's going on? But also.
Sorry, it was the medicine.
Yeah, it's the medicine talking. Also, you got to drain the bank accounts. You got to run up the credit cards. You got to double mortgage the house or sell the house for out front to your wife or whatever it is. I mean, you got to financially ruin them also. So I think you debase their name in public. And also, you financially ruined them. And, you know, there's not much coming back from that.
Agreed. And that's kind of where I was at. I said, I'll be calling in and quitting my job.
Yeah.
I'm maxing out all of the credit lines, wiping the bank account, filing for divorce,
ooh,
or breaking up if you're not in a relationship or if you're in a relationship. Applying for the 200 credit cards that likely came in the mail in the 48 hours you had that body.
Right.
And all the while doing this while forcefully pooping your pants in public.
Wow, bro, that's messed up.
And then I got an even better one. So this was, I found this question, and one of the answers on this question blew my mind. I was like, okay, I like where your head's at. I think I'm going to take his answer. The best and most ruthless answer, I've got 47 hours where I'm going to sit in waiting. Then on the last hour, I will proceed to eat 15 ghost peppers with a little treat I like to call the leftover food scraps from Taco Bell from 3 weeks ago, combined with 5 kilos of rotten dog food.
Yeah.
I then swallow a whole bottle of laxatives, super glue my mouth and asshole shut, and get out of there and wait for the fun to begin.
Man, that's, gosh.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah, you kill the folk. I mean, technically, you wouldn't kill him while you're in there.
Technically, you wouldn't. I mean, not while you're in him.
He'd literally just suffocate to death on his own vomit.
I tell you what, you can take that same premise, and then you can go to, like, you've got 48 hours, so with 40 hours of it is going to be flying to Australia. When you get to Australia, you want to find the Gympie tree. And then when you have, oh, God, I don't know, maybe 15, 20 minutes left, you go up and strip down butt naked and then hug the tree and slide all the way down it and cover your entire body with as much of the Gympie Gympie as you can. And they call that one, the Gympie Gympie is the suicide tree, because what it does is it has these little hairs, and the hairs release these neurotoxins that inflict unimaginable pain. And the crazy part about it is you can't surgically remove all of the hairs, because it goes up into your skin and your skin will actually heal up over it pretty fast. So you basically have for anywhere between 6 months to, I think they said like a year or 2 years, where you can have a full on re-engagement of the entire pain episode. And then you also run the risk of it just lasting your entire life if your body doesn't break down those fibers, because it'll just consistently keep releasing that poison into your body and doesn't run out.
Wow. Well, that sounds pleasant.
Could be fun.
Gosh. I'll admit, there's no one that I dislike enough to do any of that to.
I know. That's why this is a hypothetical.
Yeah, I would have, like, there are some folks that I don't enjoy being around, but I don't genuinely dislike very many people.
I agree with you 100%. There's nobody that I associate with or even converse with on any sort of basis that I would do that to.
Well,
even given the option.
What'd you call it, a gimp tree?
Gympie Gympie.
Good grief, bro. That's messed up.
I'll send it to you when we get off air.
All right. Well,
and I don't we'll keep PG, I guess.
Yes, please. Please keep it. Sounds horrendous enough.
I'm gonna send you a picture of that Gympie Gympie.
Oh, good grief. I don't know if I can handle that. All right. Well, let's get out of here. Let's do some updates and we'll sign off for the week. You ready for that?
Oh, I do want to clarify, it's the Gympie Gympie plant.
Oh, it's a plant. It's not a tree. I don't know. Yeah. That doesn't make it any better.
Yeah, poison ivy on steroids.
Nice, nice. All right, let's do some updates.
Hey, that's the news update for you today.
Got it, even though you're remote, my friend.
Well, because I ate my kick-ass this morning.
Well, first and foremost, we don't get this every week, but we got a nice voicemail call-in from a couple weeks ago from Nurse Ashley. Ooh. She's going to clarify.
Oh, yeah, this was last week.
Yeah, she's going to clarify a couple of things, and then she kind of wishes us well, and we appreciate it. So let's take a listen to what she has to say.
Hey, guys, Nurse Ashley here. So there was an episode, I think, I don't remember, maybe 43 or something like that.
Get your crap together.
Trouble coming up with the word starts with a C, similar to coitus, similar to sex. Copulate, that's the word you were looking for.
Okay, so copulate, I paused it because not only did Nurse Ashley correct us in this message, but also like the day after that episode dropped, Nicole Olio, she sent me a message. She was like, the word you're looking for is copulate. So we got two good ladies there watching out for us, watching our backs.
They called us out. Called us out.
All right, let's go on.
So you're welcome. They're also, I'm in the middle of the Halloween episode right now. Y'all shouted out to me about the sleep paralysis and treatment for it.
Yeah.
I don't know if there's
that's a good episode.
Is, but I know that they can do sleep studies, and there is like an electrical impulse type treatment that they can do that helps with like behavioral type of stuff that will basically tell your brain when certain things activate it retrains it to not activate that way or whatever. So I don't know if that's even an option for sleep paralysis, but maybe it would be. And I also was thinking that this person could be experiencing absent seizures. And that is, of course, a medical condition that needs to be checked out. So I don't know. Maybe that's what that patient is going through. And yeah, they should for sure get that checked out. But I'm going to hop off of here and continue listening to the episode. Love you guys.
Yeah, we love you too.
So I'm gonna go with my original assertion. They should probably go see a doctor.
Yeah, you should probably do that.
And by the way, the Halloween episode is pretty legit.
I thoroughly enjoyed that episode.
I think that's probably one of my favorites, if not my favorite. It was a good episode.
Yeah, it's definitely rolling on up there with one of the top fives. Faux show.
Well, do you got any other quick updates we need to know about? Anything's brewing in your backwoods, so to speak?
Oh, my Lanta.
That's brewing in my. That's a moonshine reference. It's a moonshine reference.
My backwoods is always that's always on the table.
Always. Why you gotta make everything gross?
Bro, you've known me for like 65 years.
I was legitimately talking about moonshine. That's a moonshine reference.
Oh. Well, I don't brew moonshine anymore.
Anymore?
No, actually, I was meaning to tell you that's why we're doing this on cell phones because I'm starting a new moonshine operation.
Oh, nice!
And can't quite disclose where I'm at. This is a burner phone. I'm calling you on.
Nice. I knew I didn't recognize the number for some reason.
You called me.
I know your world, sucker.
I did. As for updates. We got some cocoa in.
Yeah, we did. Finally.
I gotta say, United States Postal Service, some pretty solid folk.
Yep.
It's when you start dabbling into the private sector and FedEx.
Yep.
Oh, never mind. I'm not gonna say names.
Well, you already did. You done did it.
Yeah, I fixed it in post.
Okay. I
will just blame. We'll say it was Static.
Oh, right.
Couldn't hear the name anyway. but they have finally worked out shipping issues with Coco Cocktail.
Nice.
So I got to say, I'm pretty excited. I got a couple of cold cocos in the refrigerator waiting for me this weekend.
Well, beautiful. All right, man. Well, I'll tell you what. Coco's, it's a good addition, and I'm glad that we didn't have to abandon ship on them because the product's fantastic, and really, really happy that's going to continue to work out. Eccentric Brewing is something that we're, what would you say, that relationship is brewing, and we hope something really, really pans out with them through the holidays.
Very nice.
So we want to thank them, and then also Ballsy and Manly Man Co., great sponsors, or excuse me, affiliates. You can check out all their stuff in the link below. All the description
Bottle
is
Keeper.
In there. Bottle Keeper, all that good stuff. And we want to say thank you to what? What? You keep interrupting me.
You can't forget our newest one. You can't forget our newest affiliate.
I didn't even know we had one.
It's the Beer Connoisseur.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
So, yeah, we're actually going to work on getting a pretty legit commercial worked up for these guys. You can check out on our website. We've got all of the affiliates and the sponsors links. So go visit these guys. It really helps us out. And take it away.
And take it away. We, as always, we want to thank the OGs and the newbies. Thanks, you guys, that have been around from the very beginning. And also thank you for the new guys that are just found us. And we hope you enjoy. And don't judge us off this episode. Call-ins are notoriously difficult because timing's off and you can't judge on – you can't play off each other in any way. It's challenging.
Wow.
So anyway, it is what it is. But we got you some good information today. We hope you guys enjoyed it. I want to say thank you to all of y'all. And head over to the website, www.fwgpodcast.com. You can leave us a voicemail. You can leave us a review. All of those things help in the algorithm. We'd really appreciate it. You can go over to Facebook and join our Cult of the Life Shippers group. That's where all the magic happens. And there's like five of us that just post every single day. And about the best memes.
We got some winners.
Yep. We're probably going to get deleted before too long because the Zuckerberg, he's not going to put up with it much longer. But for now, get in there while the getting's good, because it's good, and we really enjoy over there. So that's how you can find us. Download us on all of your podcast platforms. It really helps whenever you click subscribe. It helps the algorithms and blah, 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 so that helps. Reviews helps. Any kind of content you want to feed us for questions, anything like that, we'd be more than happy to put it on the air, and we might even let you call in if you got something really good. So let us know. We'll help you.
Even if you got something subpar, we'll probably put it on.
We'll probably put it on anyway.
You made it to this part of the episode listening to me, so
yeah,
you're subpar anyway.
I guess that's probably true. Or... All right, last but not least, thank you to our wives for allowing us to do this, and it takes a lot out of them, and it takes a lot out of us, and we're just happy to be able to put it on. We hope it continues in the future. Hey, Beezy, you ready for a little ponder this?
Oh, I reckon so.
All right.
Ponder this?
Wait. Dude, you're moving your phone around or whatever. It's like all this static in the ponder. It's hilarious.
Well, let's do it again. I'll set my phone. I was picking the phone up to get it closer to my head.
All right, I may leave that in post. That's pretty funny. All right, here we go. Ponder this.
Ponder this? Oh, this part of this is actually very fitting for how things have been going as of late with the Cult of the Life Shippers.
All right.
So, if Facebook has the audacity to put you in jail, they should at least connect you with other users who are also in jail so you can start gangs and get tattoos.
That would be awesome to have a Facebook jail group.
Facebook prison gang.
Facebook prison group. It'd be like the Facebook San Quentin.
Oh, Facebook prison tat. Yeah, I got a thumbs up under my eye. I killed a person in Facebook prison. Tanked the hoe.
What are you in for? Oh, I posted a meme about Joe Biden. They couldn't handle that.
No, even better. What are you in for? I made a post back in 2012.
Yeah, 2012, they found it. They found it, by God.
I guess there's no such thing as statute of limitations. I'm not.
All right, man, let's get out of here. We'll see y'all next time. Dude, how mad do you think the cats are that listen to this podcast are?
You know what? I don't really care. If they have an issue, they know exactly how to leave us a voice message.
It's true.
They know how to send us an email. And there's about 9,000 ways they can contact us. Theseguysquestions@gmail.com. The website. Send us your address. I'll drop a deuce in your cat box. Show you who's daddy.
So what you're saying is you don't care about the kitties?
I don't care about them kitties.
All right, Beezy. We'll catch you next time.
Later, brother.